Well, first I asked if you're Catholic. She said yes. And she said, I was always working, the priest was too busy, but I never received instruction. And so I knew what all of our priests would say, but I checked with Father John, because I was like, as we are reminded, deacons are not lone rangers. So I checked with Father John, and he said, well, ask her if she believes that the living Jesus is in the Eucharist. So I asked her, she said yes. And so I brought her communion, and so when I gave her communion, her eyes were glistening, teary. Now, that was the third time we had been to see her. They had not got a smile, they had not just, you know, just, she was just really down. We left and she was. And now when we go back to see her, she pops up in bed and she's smiling. But she says that the therapist, she says, oh, it hurts so bad what they do to her, you know, trying to help her get moving again. And I'm sure it does. And as I said, I told her that St. Cecilia people would be praying for her. So please pray for her. Dionysia.
The Lord works in mysterious ways, John.
No kidding. I tell you, we would not have known about her because she's never been to St. Cecilia. And but anyway, I am so glad we found her, because as far as I can tell, the only person who sees her is her daughter from time to time. Her daughter lives in Nevada. She must have been visiting her daughter or something. But, oh, she was telling last night about how, well, you know, we had to walk a long way to get water and carry it back to our home, and we had to pay for it. And she was talking about how much they had to pay. But, and the young woman who was with me said, well, that's not unusual. We had to walk a long way too and pay for the water. So, you know, we think all the things that we have, good heavens. Oh my goodness. So, now, that was ordinary life for them. So let's begin in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and enable them to fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, and by the light of the Holy Spirit, give instruct the hearts of the faithful, and that by the same Holy Spirit, we may truly wise and ever rejoice in this consolation. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, we're in, let's see, according to my note, we were at ready to continue chapter 17, verse 15. And the, in order to get the context, I think we should read that chapter. I want to say again, I will not be here for the next two Tuesdays. I don't know what I told you why I was going, did I?
Yes.
Yes. My 64th high school reunion.
Wow.
Right now, they wait till next year and make it 65.
Well,
might not be,
we'll see what happens.
Can't wait.
But, it's interesting. For years and years, I was not in touch with any of those people. And we get back together. together, and I think we're closer now than aware that. You know what I mean?
Yes.
It's really great fun to get together with this.
I'm working with.
Louisville, Mississippi, spelled just like Louisville, Kentucky, but this town was named, the town and the county were named for Louis Winston, an Englishman. So it's Winston County, and Louisville is the county seat. And it's spelled L-U-I-S, his name was. So, yeah, the town is even smaller now than it was when I grew up. So maybe a stretch, 5,000. But at least that's what it used to be. Maybe smaller. It looks like it's smaller than that now. Interesting. It had the largest sawmill planing, getting furniture, not building the furniture, but preparing the lumber in the country. In the country. The company owned that, owned the grocery store, owned the ladies upscale ready-to-wear store. They kind of said they owned the town, the barber. And so the workers decided they were going to unionize because, just a huge number of people worked for them. And Mr. Thayer was not exactly generous. And so he told them, if you unionize, I'll shut the place down. They did, and he did, and the breakfast shop told them. So there's very little, several businesses have tried to go in and use that, the buildings, that kind of thing, and none of them have made it because the town is just, it was virtually destroyed when he did that. So that's the reason it's smaller now. So, let's see. Okay, Mary Lynch, may I pick on you today? I'd like you to read all of chapter 17. And if you have any questions before we get to verse 15, that'll be fine. And I'll begin examining in detail in verse 15. Okay? Chapter 17, starting at the first.
Then one of the seven angels who were holding the seven bowls came and said to me, "Come here, I will show you the judgment on the great harlot whose lives near the many waters. The kings of the earth have had intercourse with her, and the inhabitants of the earth became drunk on the wine of her harlotry." Then he carried me away in spirit to a deserted place, where I saw a woman seated on a scarlet beast that was covered with blasphemous names, with seven heads and 10 horns. The woman was wearing purple and scarlet and adorned with gold, precious stones, and pearls. She held in her hand a gold cup that was filled with the abominable and sordid deeds of her harlotry. On her forehead was written a name, which is a mystery: Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, and of the abominations of the earth. I saw that the woman was drunk on the blood of the Holy Ones and on the blood of the witnesses to Jesus. When I saw her, I was greatly amazed. The angel said to me, "Why are you amazed? I will explain to you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, the beast with the seven heads and the 10 horns. The beast that you saw existed once, but now exists no longer. It will come up from the abyss and is headed for destruction. The inhabitants of the earth whose names have not been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, shall be amazed when they see the beast, because it existed once, but exists no longer. And yet it will come again. Here's a clue for one who has wisdom. The seven heads represent seven hills upon which the woman sits. They also represent seven kings. Five have already fallen, one still lives, and the last has not yet come. And when he comes, he must remain only a short while. The beast that existed once, but exists no longer, is an eighth king, but really belongs to the seven and is headed for destruction. The ten horns that you saw represent ten kings who have not yet been crowned. They will receive royal authority along with the beast for 1 hour. They are of one mind and will give their power and authority to the beast. They will fight with the Lamb, but the Lamb will conquer them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those with him are called, chosen, and faithful. Then he said to me, the waters that you saw where the harlot lives represent large numbers of people, nations, and tongues. The ten horns that you saw and the beast will hate the harlot. They will leave her desolate and naked. They will eat her flesh and consume her with fire. For God has put it into their minds to carry out his purpose and to make them come to an agreement to give their kingdoms to the beast until the words of God are accomplished. The woman whom you saw represents the great city that has sovereignty over the kings and of the earth.
Okay, thank you. All right. This is, by the way, you know this is one of the most famous passages, sections of all of the Revelation. And as I think I mentioned to you last time, this has been used, the images from this have been used again and again and again to apply to certain characters in literary history. In Spenser's Fairy Queen, her name is Duessa, which is taken from the same word that duplicity comes from. In Chaucer, she's the wife of Bath, and you have the descriptions from that. And so this is a very, very famous because used as an image and a model for what? Total dissolution, abandonment to evil, to sensuousness sometimes, and so on. So now, remember, what we're reading is the beginning of what? Beginning of the end. So remember all those other, that whole series of sevens. Seven seals, seven bowls, seven churches, seven angels, and seven plagues, and so on. Remember all those horrible things that were happening? What was the purpose of all those things?
To get people to repentance.
To bring people to repentance. Exactly. That was what all of that was about. Now that's past. Now this is the beginning of the end. So, and this woman symbolizes or represents the great city. What great city?
Rome.
And notice, she's called not Rome, but
Beast.
No, she's called, she's not called Rome. What is she called? Remember, this is the same technique used in the book of Daniel. And even makes use of material from Daniel. Of using a name and a time in the past to to apply to the present. So, can I say, trying to read this literally, you'd have to do the little handstands, but I think some people give it a try. This is highly symbolic.
They portray this as a woman, but actually the people are kings and men.
I'm sorry?
The kings are all male.
Yes, the kings are all male.
So why is all this male is a woman dominate them? Why is that?
Haven't women always dominated males?
No.
In the sense of manipulated, but why? Because the kings were. A king is, by definition, male.
Yeah.
And there have been some very famous queens through the centuries. It's one of the Bible. Sheba. Queen of Sheba. I was thinking of another queen.
Jezebel.
Jezebel.
She was back.
Jezebel was, did you say Bath?
Yeah, Bath.
Oh,
not a good person.
No, not a good person. Jezebel was the one who tried to kill Elijah, and so on. So the idea of using a wicked queen comes from the Old Testament. Kings, of course, were usually, well, they're always men, but they were kings.
In a way, we are blamed for everything.
But notice, that is often true, seriously. But notice, you don't usually hear people talking about the sin of Eve, it's the sin of Adam. And the Bible doesn't refer to the sin of Eve, it refers to the sin of Adam. Right? Mm-hmm. However, that doesn't let women off, because what does the word Adam mean?
Mankind.
Okay, or humankind, man. Okay, so that includes women. Just
was Esther a Jewish queen?
Was Esther? She was not a Jewish queen. She was, see, in the book of Esther, they're in exile. And so she is a captive. And as a captive, is made the queen of Persia. So she was Jewish, but not a Jewish queen.
Okay.
Does that remind me of one?
Okay.
I have a question. So you said the literary device used here is when they use an older historical figure or a city to represent what is in their present. Now, can we turn that around and use this to represent what is in our present?
With great care, if we do it. And I'll tell you why I say that. There's a, and I want to be careful how I'm saying this, because it has been done by everybody. But Protestant churches are often the ones who are doing this. You notice you don't hear, have you heard or read anything about any priest or bishop saying the catastrophic things that happen in the world today are because of God's punishment?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't.
From priests and bishops?
About priests, yeah.
Very few. Correct?
Correct.
This is commonplace for evangelicals. So evangelicals are the ones who have done this for now centuries, because, and so this is the this is the typical kind of thing for Protestants to do, but not for Catholics. And do you know why not for Catholics? Silence says no. Okay. The Catholic Church has been very, very wary of labeling and condemning. Do you know we have countless, and I do mean countless, saints that have been canonized. And some not canonized are called saints. But a canonized saint means officially the church has said this person's life is worthy of imitation. Not one single person, not even Judas, has the church ever said was going to hell. Why not?
The authority.
Because the church doesn't judge.
The church does not judge. God is the judge. And so that is the reason most priests, and so far as I know, the bishops, none of them, have said that what is going on nowadays is because of the sin of the people. So, am I responding?
Yes.
So, you know, some of you, none of you as old as I, but anyway, I think you still remember, some of you old as I do remember. Okay, World War II, you know who was the beast, the Antichrist? Okay, and then Stalin, and so on. So this is kind of, but you didn't hear the church say that. You see what I mean? So I think we have to do this, if we do it all, we have to do it with very great care. Coming back to this, okay, the Babylon the Great, one of the harlots of the rest of our nation. What is the traditional understanding of idolatry in a very general, in the most general, so well, still is. What is idolatry?
Sort of like putting something above God.
A different God.
Worship a false God.
Actually, they've said worship of anything that is not God.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Worship. Okay. Now, what do you mean by worship? I think I've told you about this, and I'll make it quick, but I was working in a group of young people, and we were dealing with passages that dealt with idolatry. And so I began the class by saying, what did you spend your time on this week? And I said, what did you spend your money on this week? What were you doing most of the time? What were you thinking about? And they said, now you say you're God. They were furious with me. For good reason. That was a trick. That was unfair. But you know what I was thinking? Well, what do we give our time and money and attention to? That's most important to us. Is that fair? Now, to be sure, we all have to make a living and take care of our family and so on and so on. But do I need all that I have and all that I continue to get? Ruth's a great one for saying, well, do you need that, John? And notice I said, do you need that, John? I mean, it doesn't work the other way. And I say, honey, this is not about me. But you understand what I'm getting at. I'll never forget one young Protestant minister in Mississippi State who was giving a lecture. He was with the YMCA on the campus. And so it was really rather well attended. And he said, "Today I want to talk about idolatry." He said, "You know, we read about the Bible, we read the Bible, especially the Old Testament, all these people worshiping idols." He said, "I think we often get the wrong idea. They don't worship the thing itself, they worship what that represents." And he said, "What are they worshiping?" It's okay, that which can provide health, well-being, stave off illness and death and so on and so on. He said, "Don't we do the same thing? Is our focus really on God, the God of the Bible, the God of mercy and love and peace and justice and hope and so on?" He said, "Or do we spend our time worshiping things of this world that will protect us or provide for us?" It was the first time I'd ever heard that. I was shocked. So, okay, notice, now when we get a little farther, we're going to see who laments over what's happening in this beginning and the end. Okay, the 10 horns and 10 beasts, and those you told the 7 kings, I do intend to look at verse 8. Start reading that again, and I'll rudely interrupt you, Mary.
"The beast that you saw existed once, but now exists no longer. It will come up from the abyss and is headed for destruction."
Okay, now notice, the beast is going to come back, right? Okay,
does that mean he's dead?
Yes, he's dead. I mentioned this, according to rumors and so on, about Nero, he would rise again. Okay, Mary, start reading, let's see, just keep reading.
"The inhabitants of the earth whose names have not been written in the book of life."
Notice, whose names have not been written in the book of life. Keep reading.
"From the foundation of the world."
From the foundation of the world. Notice, this is, God lives outside of time, remember? Yes.
Not written.
Not written.
But then what chance do you have if you're not in the book? Why are you even put there then?
Because God knows. He doesn't determine.
So that's predetermination.
No, because God doesn't make it so. He knows it is so. Big difference.
So can you get in the book if you're not in the book?
Let me put it like this. Any person who responds to God, notice, what was the purpose of all those horrible things that happened?
Repentance.
Repentance. If it were not possible for people to change, that makes no sense. Agreed? Okay. But any person who responds to God right now, is there hope for that person?
Yes.
The person's name was written in the book of life from the foundation of the world.
That's a living book then.
Yes.
I mean, the book changes too then. I mean,
if
a character outside the book changes, the book changes.
No.
But the book already knew about the change that
God knows.
Yeah, well,
God knows from the beginning what will happen in time to come.
That you're going to change, David.
See, so it doesn't change. Because God lives where? What time?
All time.
The eternal present. God is outside of time. So, from the foundation of the world then.
Yes. Okay. We are God's thoughts.
Yes.
So then we have our name there or not? If I'm not baptized, they don't have a name?
If you're baptized, it's your name in the book. If you're not baptized, it's your name not written, not in the book. Okay, first, if you're baptized. Okay, does the church baptize anyone who requests it?
No.
I give you an example. There was a young man who grew up in this parish, and he became Mormon, Church of Latter-day Saints. So when his first child was born, he came in, and I got this from Father Terry, because Father Terry was here then, came in and asked Father Terry to baptize his son. Father Terry says, "Oh, are you coming back to the church?" He said, "No, but I just want it baptized." Father Terry said, "Trying to cover all your bases? Sorry, we can't do that." Okay, you follow?
Yeah.
So not any. Now, do we always know what parents are going to do? Indeed, we do not. And so, if a child, a person, is baptized in good faith, the name was written. It was written, you know, just what I said, from the foundation of the world.
Well, what if that person then chooses not to follow God? Then is his name removed, or was it never written in there?
It was never written.
Even though it was baptized?
Even though he was baptized. Good. Clear enough? Okay. Now, do you have to be baptized to have your name written in the book? How about this? St. Paul says, those who live outside the law, who by nature do what the law requires, are a law to themselves. They show that the law is written on the human heart. And their thoughts are, some say, their consciences. Their thoughts are consciousness. Their thoughts will accuse or perhaps excuse them on that day when, according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of the living and the dead by Christ Jesus. The church, therefore, and the catechism of the Catholic Church, says in its own way exactly that. One of the statements says, we are bound by the sacraments of the church, but God is not. Do you follow? God is not bound by the sacraments of the church. So, certainly, interesting. Centuries ago, one particular pagan emperor, king, whose name was Trajan, he was a Latin king, was regarded as probably a saint because of what he did. And this is, this then shows up in Catholic literature. Well, let me take it back to the Old Testament. Are only Jewish prophets speaking for God?
No.
A series of prophets, non-Jewish, speaking for God. Okay, is Job Jewish or Hebrew?
No.
No. All the earth is the Lord's, and all people of the earth are his children by creation. So, whose name is written in the book, it would be whose name was written in the book, God knows. And since we don't, we have to be careful. Yes.
I used to get great satisfaction thinking of Hitler roasting on a spit in hell until I realized that it's possible that he asked for forgiveness before he died.
It is possible.
So we need to be prepared to see people were not, if we get blessed to get there.
It's possible, but doubtful.
that is true. But since it is possible, we need to be careful. Do you know who is called a Messiah in the book of Isaiah?
Cyrus.
Cyrus, king of Persia.
Yeah, he was a good guy. He was probably a saint.
Well, it depends on who was set free and who was killed. Who would say that? Cyrus, king of Persia, allowed the people of Israel to return to their homeland. And so Isaiah refers to him as the Messiah. He not only allowed them to return, he gave them provisions to rebuild and so on. So, a good guy from the perspective of the Israelites for sure. I don't think the Babylonians liked him so much. Okay, let's go back now and let's start with verse 13, and then I'm going to start interrupting you at 15, Mary.
They are of one mind and will give their power and authority to the beast. They will fight with the Lamb, but the Lamb will conquer them. For he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those with him are called, chosen, and faithful.
Notice, chosen and faithful. Keep reading, please.
Then he said to me, the waters that you saw where the harlot lives represent large numbers of peoples, nations, and tongues.
Okay, notice. Dave, question would have been, what's all this waters? Oh, he tells you. You see what I mean? So often, you know why I call Dave's name? Because Dave's questions, every time he reads a question. And you know why I'm pointing you out, Dave, for this reason? Because that's what ought to happen to all of us. When we read something and it's not making sense to us, okay, why? Now, very often in Daniel and the Revelation, if we just keep reading, keep in mind the question, the book answers the question. And that is something that so often people forget the question, and then when they get an answer, it doesn't make any sense. I used to tell my students one reason, and by the way, I would ask, who was your teacher last semester? Don't remember. Well, what did you get in such and such a course? Don't remember. And I started saying to them, you know, if you have no questions, answers make no sense, and we can't remember them. 5,280, what's the question?
How many feet in a mile?
Without that question, that's just a meaningless set of numbers.
How many years did you teach?
He's still doing it. I'm
still thinking of all the people you've influenced.
Oh, my goodness.
Probably still talking about you to this day, but we just don't know it.
Some of them talking about me, not in the best of terms.
That's all right, they didn't
think. But actually, I started doing some teaching when I was a junior in college. I was an undergraduate teaching assistant. So it's 15 years.
So give me a rough
guess.
15 years.
Well,
that year was 1955.
55.
61 years.
55, 56. That was the year.
And what year did you retire from ISU?
I took retirement from ISU December 1996 or January 97. you know, I said, I live and breathe this. Because, you know, it's great fun. It really is. I have to tell you, though, something that St. Augustine said about what we're doing. He said, people, and by the way, he had obviously been criticized because he wrote and preached extensively on the Bible. I mean, volumes and volumes and volumes of his works are available now. And he said, of those who think that study of the Bible is a romp in the sun, no, it's huffing and puffing up a mountainside. Do you follow?
Yeah.
It's not something you just whip through. I think it's clear that that's not going to work here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, John,
there. Yes.
On this, what we're reading, chapter 17, we can't say this is happening, this is in the past, and we can't correlate it to the present then, right? I mean, we can't say these beasts and that are governments and kings.
No, we can't, because that is purely arbitrary. I mean, personal opinion. You know, I guess we can say it, that doesn't make it so.
But if this beast is going to come again, it has to.
But the beast already came. Remember, this is not talking about sometime centuries ahead. Now, it's talking about what was happening and it would happen shortly at that time. Okay? You told me, what place is the Babylon referred to here, that's referred to here?
Right.
Rome. Okay? Was Rome destroyed and burned? Yes. Was the whole earth, known world, affected by that? Yes. So
the lamb conquered Rome.
And well, the lamb had got. The lamb conquered everything when?
When he died.
And rose again. Yes. So again, see, we have to keep in mind, this is not sequential. This is not time as we think of it.
I bet if you ask 100 people out in the street, will the Antichrist come again, the answer would be yes.
Well,
but doesn't that contradict this then?
Okay, hang on a minute. Hang on just a minute. I think I can find this pretty quickly. Okay, I'm ready. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until the lawless one is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, and the Lord Jesus will slay him with the breath of his mouth and destroy him by his appearance and his coming.
Just, that's it.
Well, how was humankind created?
Right.
Okay, so as humankind is created by breath, evil will be destroyed by breath. The coming of the lawless one by the activity of Satan will be with all power and with pretended signs and wonders and with all wicked deception for those who are to perish. because they are to perish.
Where are you reading from?
I'll tell you in a minute. And with the coming of the lawless one by the activity of Satan will be with all power and with pretended signs and wonders and with all wicked deception for those who are to perish because they refused, did you get that? They're to perish because they refused to love the truth and so be saved.
Sounds like Paul.
It is Paul. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and I started reading with verse 7. It's that chapter was about the day of the Lord, the coming of Jesus, really. And the day of the Lord is a term taken from the prophets, you see. And that's applied to the coming of Jesus. So, there's one more thing I want to say about this before I go on. Remember, we're reading about the beginning and the end here, right? Okay. At what time in history was the beginning of the end for us?
From the beginning.
No?
Before.
Resurrection?
Yes. The resurrection of Jesus was the beginning of the end. Paul's letters deals with us. Okay, we hear about end times from our Protestant brothers and sisters. Paul talks about end times. They began with the resurrection. So, we can say the earth has been in its death throes since the resurrection.
So that would mean,
or another way to put it, the earth has been in the process of being resurrected and renewed since the resurrection. Both happened. Yes.
So that's why the second coming was written about that. Is that correct or not?
Because the second coming will be the culmination of what happened when Jesus rose from the dead. Yes.
But when he died, he says, I'll be with you always. So he's still here, but the second coming is, like a grand appearance.
The second will be the day of the Lord.
And that
will
be
culmination or completion of all things.
And he'll just breathe on a certain group, and then that'll be it.
Separate the dead.
Well, again, it almost... Not when you say a certain group. If you mean a certain group, then no. Because, again, you're dealing with timelessness, not with a period of time.
So, when we say creed, why do we say world without end?
Pardon?
When we say creed, why do we say
world without end? Because there will be a new creation coming out of the old. So, world without end. The world without end is the world created from the beginning that will continue. And of course, world does not necessarily mean the earth as we know it.
It sounds like Einstein, matter can't be created or destroyed. It never went away. It just said a mystery.
Interesting. One of my students said, there's no need for God because matter and energy have always existed and will continue to exist. And I said, your faith is greater than mine. She was not happy. But interesting. We say, what can neither be created nor destroyed? We say, matter, energy. Do you know what people in, say, 1700 would have said in answer to that question? Maybe 1800? What can neither be created nor destroyed?
God.
Say it again.
God.
That, you know what makes us called materialists? Not because we like material things. People always have done that.
We have faith in material things.
Because we have faith in material things. What can neither be created nor destroyed? Matter and energy. We're materialists. Okay, let's go ahead now. Let's see, Mary, pick up with, start again at 15.
Then he said to me, the waters that you saw where the harlot lives represent large numbers of peoples, nations, and tongues. The 10 horns that you saw and the beast will hate the harlot. They will leave her desolate and naked. They will eat her flesh and consume her with fire.
By the way, whose flesh was eaten and all sorts of grotesque things happened? Jezebel. The dogs ate her flesh and so on. Okay, keep reading.
For God has put it into their minds to carry out his purpose and to make them come to an agreement to give their kingdom to the beast until the words of God are accomplished.
Notice, it's the wicked of the earth will unite in one mind and one accord to destroy the beast. The beast, my goddaughter wrote a book on the victimizer victimized. Okay, remember last Sunday's gospel, the chief priests and the elders and the Pharisees gathered together to ask Jesus a trick question in order to arrest him, right? Okay, Jesus tells a story about the owner of a vineyard. Do you remember this? And the farmers, the people who took care of the vineyard, what did they do? They killed the servants as they came. And then finally, they only sent his son. What did the son, what did they do to the son? Okay, and Jesus said, what will the owner of that vineyard do?
You kill the wretched people, kill the vine.
No, he will not kill the vine. He will
kill
all these renters and get you. Okay? They condemned themselves. The chief priests, elders, Pharisees condemned themselves when they said what would happen to those renters. Well, all of us are renters. You know that, don't you? Everything is on loan. Life itself. Okay? So, yeah. So the evil united together to destroy evil. Start reading verse 16 again, Mary. Listen to this.
The 10 horns.
And what are 10 horns?
The 10 kings.
The 10 kings. Go ahead.
The 10 horns that you saw and the beast will hate the harlot. They will leave her desolate and naked. They will eat her flesh and consume her with fire. For God has put it into their minds to carry out his purpose and to make them come into an agreement to give their kingdom to the beast until the words of God are accomplished.
Notice they were subservient to the beast. They gave their allegiance to the beast. Is that what you said? All right, until the words of the Lord God had been accomplished, the destruction had continued.
The woman whom you saw represents the great city that has sovereignty over the kings of the earth.
Okay, do you see the idea? All those kings of the earth will rise up against her and destroy her. And it happened. That's a case where if you want to be literal here, Rome was destroyed, by invaders. Okay, Mary, read all of chapter 18 and we'll see. Well, let's see, not quite. Okay, I tell you what, read the first 8 verses and we'll look at those and see how far we get.
After this, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth became illumined by his splendor. He cried out in a mighty voice, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a haunt for demons. She is a cage for every unclean spirit, a cage for every unclean bird, a cage for every unclean and disgusting beast. For all the nations have drunk the wine of her licentious passion. The kings of the earth had intercourse with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her drive for luxury." Then I heard another voice from heaven say, "Depart from her, my people, so as not to take part in her sins and receive a share of her plagues. For her sins are piled up to the sky, and God remembers her crimes. Pay her back as she has paid others. Pay her back double for her deeds. Into her cup pour double what she poured. To the measure of her boasting and wantonness, repay her in torment and grief. For she said to herself, 'I sit enthroned as queen. I am no widow, and I will never know grief.' Therefore, her plagues will come in one day, pestilence, grief, and famine. She will be consumed by fire, for mighty is the Lord God who judges her."
Okay. Now, can we say this is the proclamation over what has happened? Okay, start reading and I'll be interrupting you here.
After this, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority, and the earth became illumined by his splendor. He cried out in a mighty voice, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great."
I can take you to the prophets because all of this material, starting with verse 2, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon," through verse 8 is, what would I say? It's a vestige, it's a putting together of quotations from Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel. Isaiah 21, Jeremiah 51, Jeremiah 50, Isaiah 48, I can do it. And sometimes there'll be a mixture of a passage from Isaiah and a passage from Jeremiah. So I could take you there, but you've seen how this is done already, haven't you? So what I'm going to do, instead of taking you there, and I mean you can see the quoted passages, is to remind you of the time Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel were living. And this is second Isaiah, not the first 39 verses, beginning with verse 40, going through through chapters 55. This is 2nd Isaiah. Do you know when 2nd Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel were writing?
After they were captive.
Okay. remember the kingdom of Judah, and that's where we get the word Jew. It's a short form of J-U. The kingdom of Judah was separate from, let's do this real quickly. Okay, you have Saul, you have David, you have Solomon, and then Solomon's son, and it was Solomon's son lost the kingdom, and so had only the kingdom of Judah separate from the kingdom of Israel. Israel was destroyed 720-21 by the Assyrians. Judah was overrun first 597, then again in 587, where it was totally destroyed by the Babylonians. Okay, questions? Questions? This is BC, of course. Any questions? Like 721, 22. Not that I guess it makes a whole bunch of difference, but, okay. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel were writing during this time. Before, during, and after. And, so, fallen is Babylon. In Isaiah, this is about what had already happened to Babylon itself. Remember, the king of Persia, Cyrus, conquered Babylon, allowed the people of Israel to return, and he gave them provisions for the journey and to rebuild their city and temple. And thus he's called the Messiah.
Why did he do that?
God willing. Interesting. Dave, because all the kings that we know about prior to this time were using a technique. They would take, and this happened to Israel, you take a group of these people and take them somewhere else. You take people from somewhere else, move them in here. People can't talk to each other. They don't speak the same language. They don't have the same culture. They don't have the same practices. Not a chance there'll be a revolution there. Got it? But you never forget being invaded. That's one of the things I've told you makes me sad and uncomfortable and concerned about being released. Remember, I grew up in Mississippi, 1950s, 40s and 50s, and the war for me, seriously, was the Civil War. Not the war with Spain, you know, Spanish-American War, not World War I, not World War II, which was going on and then completed during that time. The war for me was the Civil War. You know why?
You were invaded.
We were invaded. You'll never forget that. I know. That seems bad. How could that be? Well, all I can tell you is that's what I heard my grandmother talk about.
It was the culture.
It was, I'll never forget. This was 1957. I worked for the State Welfare Department here in Children and Youth doing research. No, it was in Hinds County, the most urban county in Mississippi. And in those days, not all the roads were paved the way they are now. And there were no signs telling you where to go or anything. So I would stop periodically and ask directions, you know, up in this area. Well, I saw a house that was obviously quite old. And the driveway was a semicircular driveway with gnarled old cedars along it. Great big magnolia tree at the front, naturally. So I drove up there and knocked on the door. Before I could say a word, a white-haired woman said, "Oh, do come in." I had to go in and sit down in the parlor. It looked like I had gone back a century. And then looking around, I said, your home is beautiful. She said, oh, as if I knew the names. So-and-so does not keep up the way so-and-so did. But do you know, the Yankees were actually in this house. They were in this house. Now, they didn't get over to such and such a hill, but they were in this house. 1957. Almost 100 years after the war was over. Do you see what I mean? Mm-hmm.
Yes. Wasn't Osama bin Laden's original complaint was that we invaded and we had no business there, and he did not want the infidels in his country, and we just left, it would be fine?
I don't know that it was expressed quite that way, but there was certainly statements to that effect. And,
I mean, he was the first one to publicly say this.
And see, that's what I don't know. But I do know that that statement seems to have been made, yes. But, this is... I'm just going by. Okay, let's go back now and start reading verse 2. Let's start with verse 2.
He cried out in a mighty voice, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a haunt for demons. She is a cage for every unclean spirit, a cage for every unclean bird, a cage for every unclean and disgusting beast."
In other words, every rotten, terrible thing you can think of, ghosts and who over knows what, it's now destroyed. And okay, we see on television sometimes a part of in Iraq where, what is the name of the city that was occupied by the by ISIS?
Raqqa or Mosul?
Actually, either one. I was blanking. Okay, you've seen these destroyed buildings, and occasionally you'll see one time it got me. I saw a little boy in one of those pictures, only human being I saw in that destroyed area. And I think, oh, dear God, you know? But, all right, this is the kind of thing that is an attempt, because when the people leave, you know what comes in? All sorts of animals take up. Oh, goodness. Raccoons. I can just imagine the raccoons having a party. We've had a few visitors that there's those raccoons coming. Okay, keep reading.
For all the nations have drunk the wine her licentious passion. The kings of the earth had intercourse with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her drive for luxury.
Notice, merchants of the earth grew rich from her. Of course. See, it's a mixture of all kinds of things here. Okay, keep reading.
Then I heard another voice from heaven say, "Depart from her, my people."
Okay. Do you know this? You could go to Isaiah, you could go to Ezekiel, you could go to Jeremiah, and you have all of them say, come out from her. What is it in the original, in the prophets, what are they talking about?
The Exodus.
Notice. Come out from her. You can now. See, come out from her. Notice, is this saying come out from a literal place? Maybe, but it's also saying come out of the sinfulness of that place.
So that other voice from heaven, they're not describing particularly who that is?
Notice the voice from heaven is usually God. God himself. Otherwise, he sends a messenger.